number four. I'm going to read very, very well-known, verse of scripture this morning. And then I'm going to bring the message I felt like the Lord laid on my heart. I do hope each one of y'all had a happy 4th of July weekend. And I appreciate your country that God's given us to live in. You can't do this in a lot of places. Thank God for America. It ain't everything it should be, but glory to God, it's still. All them people fuss about it, you don't see them moving, do you? Amen. They love living here, but they just don't know what we got to be thankful for. We got a lot to be thankful for. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 16. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 16. Let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace. As Brandon mentioned this morning, they started out singing Amazing Grace. We sing about keep on praying. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. I want to preach this morning on the subject, faces of grace. Faces of grace. The grace of God is such a huge, immense subject in the Word of God that it's not just a one-side or two-side issue or attribute. It has many faces, and it's all still grace. The word grace is mentioned some 170 times in the Bible. We all have heard the song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. But a lot of times we don't appreciate nor understand what meaning that word grace. Somebody put it like G-R-A-C-E, God's riches at Christ's expense. That's a good definition of the word grace. Other great preachers have said this. Dr. R.E. Neighbor said, grace is the immeasurable and unmerited favor of God. That's a good one. Charles Spurgeon said this, grace is something that's in God which is at the heart of all his redeeming activities. Ever the saving plan of God through the ages, grace is at the heart of it. Dr. C.I. Schofield, to me, had the best definition of modern day definition of grace, and he said it like this. He said, grace is the unmerited, unrecompensed, undeserved favor of God. That's a good definition of grace. Grace, gracious, graciously is many, many times in the Bible, and I'll talk about it this morning. I want to talk several things about it this morning, and the first thing I want to mention is sovereign grace. Sovereign grace. Let me tell you what sovereign grace is. It means that the grace of God actually reaches out and has to us before we ever even know the Lord. Have you ever read about the man who wrote the song Amazing? Can you imagine being accredited with writing Amazing Grace? That's one of the most popular songs in the history of the world. It may be the most, I don't know. But one of the greatest songs that had been written was written by a man who was on a slave trader ship back in the late 1700s by the name of John Newton. And John Newton was on that ship traveling. He was a wicked, wicked, ungodly man. And he grew up wicked. He grew up in the world as a drunk and a cussing, blaspheming man. And he's out there in a storm on that ship. And somebody talked to him about the Lord. And John Newton got saved. And John Newton got saved. And he wrote that song. And when he said, I thank the Lord for that and what he done for me. And John Newton wrote, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Everybody who really gets saved can relate to that just like that. That's exactly what happened to me. It was amazing the night the Lord saved me at Nebo Baptist Church. I was lost, and now I'm found. I was blind, but now I can see. There's only one way to describe that. Amazing. You know, people nowadays, that's the current word. People say, have you been to that restaurant? It's amazing. Have you seen that store? It's amazing. I don't know if all that stuff's amazing or not. I believe you just like to say it because you think it's trendy and cool. But I'll tell you what's amazing, brother. Grace is amazing. It's amazing. It's unbelievable. The grace of God. Old John Newton wound up pastoring churches and wrote 200 songs on his life. That's grace right there. And this old boy one night went down to the river to commit suicide. And he had decided that life wasn't worth it. He didn't want to live no more. So he took a gun and he said, I'll just go down there to that river and blow my brains out. And he got down there and got closer and closer and closer. Had every intention of taking his life. And when he got down there, he heard something. He heard way off in the distance, it sounded like somebody singing. And he said, what is that? And he kept listening. He said, he took another step, he heard an unusual sound of singing coming out up from over across the hill. And he walked up and he saw there's a little cottage prayer meeting going on with a bunch of Christians in there singing. And he said he heard that, and he said something just tugged on him and tugged on him. And he went a little further and went over the hill and went over there and peeped in, and there were Christians in there singing and worshiping and praying like Bobby said when the Lord got him down in the basement. I never knew that, brother. You should have told me. I could have shouted about that a long time ago. I never knew that until Jerry got up there and said it. But he said, you know what? He said something was tugging at him and tugging at him. And he said he went down there, and the first thing you know, he wound up in there getting saved by the grace of God. He got saved, and he was that close to going to hell. That close to putting that gun to his head and killing him and wound up whoop, whoop, and turned toward heaven. That's sovereign grace, brother. That's the grace of God. I'll never forget that night the Lord pulled me in. I'll never forget that night as an 18-year-old boy at Nebo Baptist Church when the Lord spoke to me and I found the grace of God. And so do you. Now, number two, I want to talk about saving grace. Saving grace. Now the Bible said in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, for by grace are you saved through faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And basically, that's saying this, a lock can close by itself, but cannot be opened without a key. So you get into a sin and a mess by yourself and cannot get out without grace. By grace are you saved through faith. Let me explain it like this. If a man works and gets paid, that's wage. That's wage. If a man competes and wins, that's a prize. If a man gives service and was given something, that's an award. But when you can do nothing, say nothing, be nothing, give nothing, contribute nothing, and still get it, that's grace. And that's what I was. Then I didn't even know that song, but I felt it in my heart. I didn't even know that old song that said, nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. But in my heart I'm in it. Glory to God, people, hallelujah, thank God, thank God, thank God. You know, the longer I live, the more sorry I know I am, the more sinful I know I am. My nature's a sin. I'm the chief of sinners. I'm a wretched sinner. And oh, I know the longer I go, it's God's grace. It's all by his grace. It's all by his goodness. That's saving grace. You know, we're living in a day of Christian celebrities. And that Christian celebrity doctrine is far removed from Bible doctrine. I mean, I think you ought to honor people and respect people and stuff like that. But, you know, and now we're going to introduce the great doctor so-and-so or the great singer so-and-so. You know what Paul said he was? He said, I'm the chief of sinners. That's what we ought to do. We have a big famous preacher in some of them. All right, now come on, chief of sinners, and preach to us. That's right, because that's what he is. Come on, wretch. All right, we'll have Brother Wretch come on and give his testimony. That's what we are. To save a wretch like me. You say, oh, that's before he saved. Romans 7 wasn't before he saved. He said, oh, wretched man that I was. He said, oh, wretched man that I am. That I am. Heard a guy on the radio and his Yankee accent about, I couldn't hardly stand it to start with. And he said, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a man like me. The guy would not admit he's a wretch. Boy, you know what they used to say? He done got above his raisin. You're a little too big for your britches if you can't admit you're a wretch. Amen? I mean, all the TV preachers ought to get up and say, folks, I am a wretch, saved by the grace of God. I'll give you $20 if you hear some of these big shot preachers say, hey, it ain't going to happen. But we are. We are. You know what? That's saving grace. Saving grace. But then I want to say thirdly this morning, listen to me. I want to say another face of grace is schooling grace. Schooling grace. Now, the grace of God draws you, saves you, and then immediately puts you in school, and he's a teacher. He's your teacher. And there are no graduates walking around down here on this earth. We're not graduated yet. We are students of the Lord in the Lord's school, every single one of us. And you know what? You say, I don't believe that, preacher. Let me quote you a verse of scripture, Titus chapter 2, 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation. And it said, the next verse said, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. It's not a Pharisaical thing when we say, I don't think this is right and I'm not going to do it. The grace of God teaches you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. And let me say to you, all you pre-peoples out there listening around the country, I mean, there's a whole lot more people hear this sermon out yonder and around the world than there are in here this morning. And I want to tell you, people got your doctrine twisted up. If all your preacher ever says is, oh, well, nobody, you know, it's God's grace, and you're free to make your own decisions and you got all kind of liberty and everything. You better watch that kind of talk. And that is true. That is true. We do have liberty in Christ, but the grace of God will teach you to deny ungodliness. Sure will. It sure will. I ain't never done a work good enough to save me, and you ain't either. You ain't never seen nobody believes in salvation by grace more than Brother Danny. I know I ought to be in hell. I know I could never be good enough to satisfy God. I know that my absolute best is filthy rags. I know that. But I'll tell you something else, too. When you get your heart right with God, something inside you says, that ain't right. Stay away from there. Don't do that. Don't go there. Don't listen to that. The grace of God will school you if you'll let it. It'll school you that teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust. It sure will. It'll take you from the mire and put you in the choir, brother. It'll take you off 100 proof and put you on living water, just like that. There's something about the grace of God. When you really get right with God, you know what it'll do? There's something in you that says, this ain't right. This ain't right. And the most miserable guy in town is somebody that's really saved, or who's at the beach right now, and they're saved and backslidden, they're with a bunch of sinners, or they're out in a bar last night, and the whole time they're sitting there, the grace of God saying, this isn't right, this isn't right, you ain't got no business being here, you know you shouldn't be doing this. And you say, whatever. The grace of God will teach you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Lord, what was worldly lust back in them days? No TV, no internet, no cell phone. I get a kick out of all these preachers. Some of them hears me. All these preachers all these years said TV's an abomination, wouldn't have a TV, and got the internet. That's the biggest joke I've ever heard in my life. Listen, brother, that internet's 10,000 times worse than TV ever thought about. Amen? Don't, please, y'all. It's too pretty a day to act dumb. You know good and well that internet's full of trash, about 99% of it. I'm telling you, that's schooling grace. And then let me say fourthly this morning, I'm going to talk about sufficient grace. Sufficient grace. You can preach a whole sermon on that. Sufficient grace. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, God told Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee. Amen. Now listen, Paul the apostle had what we call a thorn in the flesh. How many of you ever heard that term, thorn in the flesh? Okay, most of you have. The Apostle Paul, the great Apostle Paul that seen dead people get up, the great Apostle Paul that reached out and healed, took up sick people, take handkerchiefs from his body and lay them on people and they'd get well. The Apostle Paul had something in his flesh that really, really hindered him from serving God. And Paul thought, if it wasn't for this one thing, I could really live right. Now, everybody sitting in here this morning, you're thinking of something right now. If it wasn't for this, I could have really done something for God. If it wasn't for that, I could have really done something for God. And Paul thought that. He's a very educated man, a very holy man in his lifestyle. And one night they had a prayer meeting. This is just my vision of it. And they're all sitting around saying, anybody got any requests? And Paul said, I got one. They said, what is it, preacher? Are you praying for the heathen over yonder in Athens and Greece where you're going? I got a thorn in the flesh, and I wish y'all would pray the Lord to take it out. Well, what is it, Paul? Well, I can't say it because if I say it, people might think that's all it was, but I want to say it so that all the people down through the next couple thousand years can relate it to their story. I tell you what it wasn't. Bad eyesight. Every preacher in the country teaches it's bad eyesight. I don't know how in the name of the Lord bad eyesight can be called a messenger of Satan. Somebody explain that to me. A messenger of Satan? And you know what Paul told him? He said, my temptation in my flesh you despise not. Paul had something that the devil used on him continually that he never did really get the victory over. And our modern day preachers, they don't want to hear that. They don't want to believe that. Not Paul. You know what? Next Saturday night, they come and had another prayer meeting. Anybody got any prayer requests? Paul said, I got one. Would y'all pray the Lord to take this out of me? They said, Paul, you saw him on the road to Damascus. You got handkerchiefs they can lay on you and take it and heal people. You mean God didn't answer your prayer? No. Can we ask him again? He said, all right, we'll ask him again. Oh, God. Take us out of Paul's thorn. Take it out of his flesh. Now, the reason they say he had bad eyesight because he said, you see how large a letter I've written to you? I don't know. It was a messenger of Satan, and it was a temptation. I'm the only preacher I know that even preaches that. I'm sure there are some, but I never have got where they figured that out to be some kind of sickness. I know he said our strength will make perfect weakness, and infirmities and all that kind of stuff, but weakness don't always mean a physical weakness. That's right. So the next week came. Anybody got any prayer requests? Paul raised his hand again. I got one. Well, what is it, preacher? I got this thorn in my flesh. Man, I could have tent revivals and see thousands of people saved and everything if it wasn't for this one thing. They said, Paul? The apostle Paul? This makes three times. We'll ask the Lord, take it out. Where's your faith, boy? You raised dead people. Name it and claim it, Paul. We're our feet's on the enemy. We're treading on the serpents. That devil has no power over us. Haven't you ever watched Jesse Duplantis? He just popped in my head. There's about 5,000 of them like that. And Paul said, yeah, I have. But somehow or another, I can't get this out. I hear what they're saying. I listen to Joyce. But for some reason, I can't get the victory over this. And after the third time, he said, Lord, why can't you do it? And you know what the Lord said? Sit down, Paul, I'll tell you something. Yeah. And he said, listen. He said, lest you should be exalted above measure. You get the big head, Paul, if I didn't give you a little thorn right there just to keep you down just a little bit. I see a bunch of heads nodding right now. Listen, if God took everything away from you that hinders you, you'd be so stuck up and self-righteous, you wouldn't speak to nobody, you'd look down on other people. But like the old preacher said, every dog got just enough fleas to remind him he's a dog. And every Christian has just enough faults and flaws to remind us we're still a sinner. And I'm telling you this morning, ladies and gentlemen, that grace, Paul, God looked down at Paul and said, Paul, I ain't going to do it. I'm going to leave it in there. I know you think you could run better. I know you think you could preach better if I'd take it out. But he said, my strength is made perfect in your weakness. And he said, my grace is sufficient. And old Paul went on, far as I know, he never did pray about that no more. He said, I wish I didn't have it, and I have to run like this, but I'm a running, glory to God. I have to hobble. I come in on crutches, but I'm coming in. I'm telling you this morning, by God's grace, we're all like that. We're all handicapped. We're all, brother. People said one time, they said, you got any handicapped people in your church? I said, yes, all of us. We're all handicapped. There ain't no perfect individual in here this morning. And if you think you are, you're worse than all of us. I'm telling you, that's sufficient grace. I've discovered that whatever you might be struggling with this morning, you just turn it over to the Lord and say, by the grace of God, I'm still going on. I'm still preaching. I'm still witnessing. I'm still giving out tracts. I'm still going to knock on somebody's door. I'm still going to witness to my neighbor, because His grace is sufficient. Then I'll say number five this morning, sustaining grace. Sustaining grace. What is that? Well, 2 Timothy 1:9, who hath saved us. Sustaining grace. Sustained you through heartbreak. Sustained you through a divorce. Sustained you through a loss of a loved one. Or a trip to the funeral home. Or a bout with cancer. Sustaining grace. Sustaining grace means it'll stabilize you and steady you if you got to go to court. If you may be threatened with jail time. You may think, if I got to even go to prison, or maybe you got cancer, or maybe you just feel like you're just the biggest mess in the world, and God, listen, His grace is sustaining. It's sustaining. Amen. We're living in some bad times, people. We are living in a time right now that none of us would have believed would even be possible 6 months ago. All of a sudden, the whole world has changed. They said, I said earlier, somebody, I don't know how they got this statistic, but they said that 67% of the churches in America are shut down right now. That means 67% of people who would go to church ain't been in about 4 months now. Part of March, April, May, and June. Not even been to church. And at the same time, wickedness has got worse and worse and worse and worse. Thank God we live here in North Carolina, and God's grace has let us have church. We ain't no better than nobody else. But I'm telling you, no matter how bad it gets, if they padlock them doors, and if they say you're no longer able to even meet together in my name, we will do, by the help of God, what Christians done throughout the ages, and meet as much as we can, when we can, where we can, and the grace of God will sustain us. FDR made a statement, so you go, and I've heard it quoted on the news several times in the last few months, and you might have heard it too. He said, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. You'd have to be a politician to say something that dumb. That's one of the dumbest things a man's ever said. We talking about we have nothing to fear but fear itself. That ain't the Bible. You know what the Bible said? You better fear God. You better fear God. You better fear God. One man said, well, that don't really mean fear. Why should you be afraid of Him? He's a loving Heavenly Father. And all those mega preachers twist it around and say it don't really mean be afraid of. Oh, yes, it does. It means be afraid of Him. Anybody with a good daddy knows exactly what that verse means. My daddy loved me, but I was a little bit scared of him. Especially when I wasn't doing what I was supposed to do. And that's the way we fear God. We fear God because we know He can pull a plug on you anytime He wants to. Son, all He's got to do is just go, ding, and you'll be in the hospital for 5 years and then die. That's right. You say, well, God wouldn't do that. He's already done it. To millions and millions. You better fear God. You better fear God. But I tell you what, we need the Lord's sustaining grace. John Newton, the man I mentioned a minute ago, he said, when I was young, I was sure of many things. And that's so true. I find myself like that. When I was a young preacher, I had all the answers. I thought I knew everything. I knew what was wrong with everybody and everything. And he said, when I was a young man, I was sure of many things. He said, now I'm only sure of two things. One, I'm a miserable sinner. And two, Jesus Christ is a sufficient Savior. The older you get, the more them two things come out the most. That's really all you got, buddy. All you got when it's coming down to the end is, I'm a terrible sinner, and he's a great Savior. You know what that is? That is sustaining grace. But let me say number six this evening, quickly, it's supplying grace. Supplying grace. You know the Bible said in 2 Corinthians 9:8, God is able to make all grace abound toward you. He's able to supply all of your needs, divine grace. Now I've heard people say this. They said, Brother Danny, Daniel, when they threw him in the lion's den, he just laid down there and went to sleep. I don't think I got the grace to face a lion. Your pastor, Brother Danny, will tell you right now, I ain't got the grace to face a roaring lion. The reason I don't, there's not a roaring lion in here. Oh, well, I'm them kind, you know, the four-legged kind. There's a couple of y'all mighty close. If a lion came through that door right there, if he knew how to open that door, and he's about that tall, his bigger than big old hair looks like something, people. That was something you could saw her. When she had her hair out real big one time. Who was it, that kid? He looked at her picture and said, "Rawr." But anyway, if a big lion came through that door right there, and he had the big hair like this, or it's bigger than Dolly's, isn't it like that right there? And he come in here and his mouth open that wide, I'm trusting God that I'd have the grace. I would have grace, and I'd take off running toward that door just as fast as I could go. I thought, he can't make this curve right here. I wouldn't take time to negotiate. I wouldn't say, now calm down, kitty. I wouldn't say I wouldn't call the Greenpeace people and love the animals. I mean, I ain't got no gun on me, but if I had one, buddy, I'd shoot him right in the nose. I would. And God would give me grace. I've heard people say, Brother Danny, people talk about dying grace and God give them dying grace. I don't have dying grace. Well, duh. Guess why you ain't got dying grace? You ain't died. If you'll serve God and live right and trust him, when that time comes, there will come from another world extra grace to say, well, here I am. I like that song I believe old Tom Hayes wrote. He said, grace to cross the river, grace to face forever. There'll be new grace when it's my time to go. I'd like to encourage you, if you'll live right and serve the Lord, when dying time comes, you'll have dying grace. Amen. Number seven, I'm through. Surpassing grace. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 7 said that in the ages to come, God's grace don't just end here in this world. In the ages to come, John Newton also said this. I'll give you this quote. He said this. He said, when I get to heaven, there's going to be three things that absolutely amaze me. Number one, I will be amazed at all the people that's there that I didn't think was going. He said, number two, I'm really going to be amazed at all the people that ain't there that I thought was going. And he said, number three, I'll be most amazed that I am there and I'm gone. That's good, boy. That's surpassing grace. That's surpassing grace. Ladies and gentlemen, in the ages to come, listen, brother, you hear me. You hear me. You hear me well. Only a sinner saved by grace is what all of us are. You can be saved this morning. If you've never been saved and you don't know what I'm talking about, do it today. Put your trust in the Lord. Get down on your knees right here at this altar like some did a while ago. Get out of your seat. Walk down here. Say, Lord, save me by grace. Save me by grace. You can't be good enough to accept the free gift. Accept the free gift. Listen, here's a story and I'm through. Years ago, Queen Elizabeth, there was a lady was hired by somebody who tried to assassinate the queen. And somehow or another, the plot was foiled, and they caught her, tried to kill the queen, going to kill her. and they caught this woman and brought her in, and everybody thought, oh boy, I tell you what, the queen will have her fried, buddy. I guarantee you that. And Queen Elizabeth, they said, looked down, and that woman had a repentant heart, and she was sorry and said, I pardon you. Completely dismissed all charges. Ain't many people do that. You tried to kill me, put them in jail the rest of their life. I don't have to worry about them. Queen Elizabeth said, you're pardoned. And that woman was so touched that she fell down on her knees and said, I'll serve you the rest of my life. You had a chance to take my life and you didn't. You graciously pardoned me. I'll be your servant the rest of my life. That's exactly what happened to me. I came to the Lord one night, and he could have said, Danny, you deserve to go to hell, and I will send you there right now. And I couldn't have said nothing, but you're right, you're right, you're right. And he said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to pardon you. And I said, I'll serve you the rest of my life. I'll serve you the rest of my life. The Lord deserves you to serve him because God's grace is surpassing. Let's stand with our heads bowed, please. Every head bowed and every eye closed. No one's moving. No one's looking around. We got a song ready this morning. Every head bowed. Every eye closed. Nobody's moving. Let's take just a minute this morning. Maybe there's someone here to say, preacher, I've been going through a really, really, really bad time, and I need grace. I need God's grace. We started the service this morning. Brandon didn't know what I was going to preach on, but we started the service this morning with that song. Boys, just like the Lord said, we're on track. And then we sung that song, Tell Me the Story, How the King of All Glory. And then the girls sing that song, I Keep Praying, I Keep Praying. Somebody here needs an extra dose of grace this morning. It'd be a good time to get it. She's playing softly. If you're here and you've never been saved, you can be saved. You can be saved. You can be saved today. How? By God's grace. Heavenly Father, do what ought to be done right now. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Do what ought to be done in our lives. We love you. Oh God, touch every single heart this morning and save that one which is lost. Encourage everybody else. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Amen. We're singing. A lot of kids in the altar, young people, mamas, daddies. Let's all sing right now. Ready? Sing.
Amazing grace.
Amen. Hallelujah.
How sweet the sound.
Come on. Come on right now.
That
Help him sing, y'all.
Like me.
Everybody, let's see you sing.
I once was lost.
Say it, folks.
But
sing together. It ought to mean something to you.
Was grace that taught my heart to fear.
Amen.
And grace my fears relieved.
Amen. Come get you a dose of grace this morning.
How precious did that grace appear the hour I first
four. When we've been there,
when
amen. If you need to come,
there,
sing it out, folks.
10,000 years,
hallelujah.
Bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we
still praying this morning. I want to mention something to you right quick. Tonight, 6 o'clock here this evening. It's too hot to do anything else. You can go jump in Wilson Creek and be cool off and be back here in time for church at 6. I'm going to preach, Lord willing, tonight on Somebody Call 911. It's an extremely important message. Lord, don't change my mind. Somebody call 911. Be here tonight, 6 o'clock. Make that extra effort. We have a big crowd here today considering it's the worst year of the Sunday of the year. This Sunday and Christmas Sunday is the worst Sunday of the year for church. That's good. I'm proud of you. It's where you need to be. You can cook hot dogs and shoot off firecrackers all evening and tonight. Be here at 6 o'clock. Everybody who's going to camp needs to be here. We're going to have a short meeting tonight after church. Load up, hit the trail tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. So be here by 8:30. Have your bags packed and ready, okay? All right. Now.